Okay, class, today we're going to learn a little bit about the scientific revolution and how it affects modern science.
There's no time to waste, so let's get started.
The scientific revolution began in the late 17th century as the practices of the Middle Ages was altered. Historical figures such as Aristotle, Galen, and Ptolemy began their positions in physics, medicine, and astronomy. These intellectuals sparked curiosity among the masses.
Aristotle and Galen had been contradicted by other thinkers. The desire to discover which school of thought was correct stimulated new scientific work that sometimes led to a complete rejection of the classical authorities.
Mathematics, so fundamental to the scientific achievements of the 16th and 17th centuries, was promoted in the Renaissance by the rediscovery of the works of ancient mathematicians and the influence of Plato.
In fact, hermetic magic had become fused with alchemaic thought into a single intellectual framework. People believed it was Hermeticism that inaugurated the shift in consciousness that made the scientific revolution possible, since there was a desire to control and dominate the natural world.
Some of the greatest achievements in the scientific revolution came in the fields such as astronomy, mechanics, and medicine.
The Ptolemaic or geocentric conception of the universe was seen as a series of concentric spheres with a fixed or motion that Earth was at its center. But this has not satisfied the professional astronomers who wish to ascertain the precise paths of heavenly bodies across the sky.
This is where Copernicus comes in. Copernicus studied both math and astronomy, and his views contradicted the Ptolemaic Earth-centered conception. He felt that Ptolemy's geocentric system was too complicated and failed to accord with the observed motions of the heavenly bodies.
Copernicus then created the heliocentric or sun-centered conception, which would offer a more accurate explanation of the heavenly bodies. Nevertheless, the shift of people's thoughts from an earth-centered system to a sun-centered system was significant, therefore raising serious questions about Aristotle's astronomy and physics, despite Copernicus's own adherence to Aristotle.
At this time, the Catholic Church remained silent and did not denounce Copernicus until the work of Galileo appeared. The denunciation came at a time when an increasing number of astronomers were being attracted to Copernicus's ideas.
This brings up a very important person who is known as Johannesburg Kepler. Kepler's work illustrated the narrow line that often separated magic and science in the scientific revolution. Kepler published his first two laws of planetary motion in 1609. Although he had accepted Copernicus's heliocentric ideas, he rejected his first law by showing that the orbits of the planets around the sun are not circular, but elliptical.
This proposition destroyed a fundamental Aristotelian tenet that Copernicus had shared, that the motion of the planets was steady and unchanging. This brought along Galileo. Galileo's observations demolished yet another aspect of the traditional cosmology in that the universe seems to be composed of material substance similar to that of the Earth, rather than the real or perfect and unchanging substance.
Galileo faced a problem principle of motion of the Aristotelian conception, which dominated the late medieval world. Therefore, Galileo made two contributions to the problem of motion.
He first demonstrated by experiments that if a uniform force is applied to an object, it would move out of accelerated speed rather than a constant speed, therefore discovering the principle of inertia.
This is where the universal law of gravitation was introduced by the wonderful Isaac Newton. Newton's work was a culmination of the theories of Copernicus, Kepler, and Galileo.
Mr. Newton even wrote a book titled Principia, where he elaborated on the three laws of motion. These are ideas that every object continues in a state of rest or uniform motion in a straight line unless deflected by a force. The rate of change in motion of an object is proportional to the force acting on it, and to every action there is equal and opposite reaction.
During this time of these brilliant individuals, advancements also occurred in the fields of medicine and chemistry.
Galen's influences on the medieval medical world were pervasive in anatomy, physiology, and disease. Galen relied on animal dissection to create his picture of human anatomy that was very inaccurate. Even when Europeans began to practice human dissection, the instruction in anatomy still relied on Galen. Physiology was also dominated by Galenic hypotheses, including the belief in two separate blood systems. Also, treatment of disease was highly influenced by Galen's doctrine of four bodily humors: blood, considered warm and moist; yellow bile, warm and dry; phlegm, cold and moist; and black bile, cold and dry.
Also, the Swiss physician and alchemist originally named, repeat after us,
Theophrastus Areolus
Bombastus von Hohenheim, changed his name to Paracelsus. meaning equal to Celsus, to indicate that he wanted rival ancient medical authorities such as Galen and Celsus. He rejected Galen's claim in health and disease were controlled by the four humors and told doctors to study nature and develop personal experience through experiment. On the other hand, he continued to subscribe to all kinds of folk belief, such as gnomes, spirit, and fairies.
Paracelsus argued that the body was a chemical system which had to be balanced not only internally, but which also had to be in harmony with its environment. On the basis of this idea, Paracelsus introduced new chemical substances into medicine, for instance, the use of the metal mercury for the treatment of syphilis.
Soon a new anatomy was created by Vesalius, a Flemish-born anatomist whose dissections of the human body helped to correct misconceptions dating from ancient times. Although surgery and anatomy were considered of little importance in comparison to the other branches of medicine, Vesalius believed that surgery had to be grounded in anatomy. Unusually, he always performed dissections himself and produced anatomical charts of the blood and nervous systems as a reference aid for his students.
Vesalius' hands-on approach to teaching anatomy enabled him to rectify some of Galen's most glaring errors. He did not hesitate. For example, to correct Galen's assertion that the great blood vessels originated from the liver, since his own observations made it apparent that they came from the heart, it was not until William Harvey's work on the circulation of blood nearly a century later that this Galenic misperception was corrected.
Harvey's works, which was based on meticulous observations and experiments, led him to demolish the ancient Greeks' erroneous contentions. He demonstrated that the heart and not the liver was the beginning point of the circulation of blood in the body, that the same blood flows in both veins and arteries, and most important, that the blood makes a complete circuit as it passes through the body. Although his works ruined Galen's theories, his ideas weren't recognized until the 1660s.
Although Paracelsus had proposed a new chemical philosophy in the 16th century, it was not until the 17th and 18th centuries that a science of chemistry arose. In the 18th century, Antoine Lavoisier invented a system of naming the chemical elements, much of which is still used today. He is regarded by many as the founder of modern chemistry.
During the Middle Ages, women who sought a life of learning were severely hampered by the traditional attitude that a woman's proper role was as a daughter, wife, and mother. But in the late 14th and early 15th centuries, new opportunities for elite women emerged as enthusiasm for the new secular learning called humanism led Europe's privileged and learned to encourage women to read and study classical and Christian texts.
By the 17th century, writer Lady Margaret Cavendish helped to popularize the ideas of the scientific revolution. Colorful, outspoken, and widely ridiculed for her eccentricities, she was one of the first to argue that theology is outside the parameters of scientific inquiry. As England's first recognized woman natural philosopher, she argued strongly for the education of women and for their involvement in science.
As an aristocrat, Cavendish was a good example of the women in France and England who worked in science.
A good example of female involvement in the scientific revolution stemming from the craft tradition was Maria Sibylla Merian, who had established a reputation as an important entomologist. In 1699, she undertook an expedition into the wilds of the Dutch colony of Suriname to collect and draw samples of plants and insect life. This led her to her most important work, The Metamorphosis of the Insects of Suriname, which she used 60 drawings to show the reproductive and development cycles.
Also, Maria Winckelmann, a German astronomer, was one of the first famous astronomers of her period due to her writings. In 1711, she published Die Vorbeerte zur großen Opposition, a well-received pamphlet in which she predicted a new comet, followed by a pamphlet concerning Jupiter and Saturn, which was, again, a blend of astronomical calculations and astrological material.
All of these women scientists were exceptional, since a life devoted to any kind of scholarship was still viewed as being at odds with the domestic duties women were expected to perform.
Although women were becoming educated, the nature and value of women had been the subject of an ongoing centuries-long debate known as the Querelle des Femmes. In other words, arguments about women. Women were originally portrayed as inherently based, prone to vice, easily swayed, and sexually insatiable.
Men believed that women should continue with these roles. Overall, the scientific revolution reaffirmed traditional ideas about women. Male scientists used the new science to spread the view that women were inferior by nature, subordinate to men, and suited by nature to play a domestic role as nutrient mothers. Jean de la Bruyère, the the 17th century French moralist, was typical when he remarked that an educated woman was like a gun that was a collector's item.
Descartes is often credited with being the father of modern philosophy. This title is justified due both to his break with the traditional scholastic Aristotelian philosophy prevalent at this time and to his development and promotion of the new mechanistic sciences.
The starting point for Descartes' new system was doubt. And he explained, at the beginning of his most famous work, The Discourse on Method, written in 1637, with his emphasis on the mind, he asserted that he would accept only those things that his reason said were true.
From his first postulate, Descartes deduced an additional principle, the separation of mind and matter. He argued that since the mind cannot be doubted, but the body and material world can, the two would be radically different. From this came an absolute duality between mind and body called Cartesian dualism.
Descartes' conclusions about the nature of the universe and human beings had important implications. He had rightly been called the father of modern rationalism.
As a result, during the 17th century, scientific learning and investigation began to increase dramatically. This development of a scientific method was crucial to the evolution of science in the modern world.
Bacon, another scientific figure, has been called the father of empiricism. His works argued for the possibility of scientific knowledge based only upon inductive reasoning and careful observation of events in nature. Most importantly, he argued this could be achieved by use of a skeptical and methodical approach whereby scientists aim to avoid misleading themselves.
While his own practical ideas did not have a long-lasting influence, the general idea of the importance and possibility of a skeptical methodology makes Bacon the father of scientific method. This marked a new turn in the rhetorical and theoretical framework for science, the practical details of which are still central in debates about science and methodology today.
Descartes, however, proposed a different approach to scientific methodology by emphasizing deduction and mathematical logic.
Another importance to the work of science was the emergence of new learned societies and journals that enabled the new scientists to communicate their ideas to each other and to disseminate them to a wider literate public.
The first of these scientific societies appeared in Italy, but those of England and France were ultimately of greater significance. Early on, both the English and the French scientific societies formally emphasized the practical value of scientific research. Scientific journals furthered this concept of cooperation. For example, the French Journal des Savants published weekly beginnings in 1665, printed results of experiments as well as general scientific knowledge.
It has been argued that the literate mercantile and property elites of Europe were attracted to the new science because it offered new ways to exploit resources for profit.
Spinoza studied Descartes' geometrical style, which influenced him greatly, and while writing for Ethics, he gained a style of writing similar to Euclid's Elements. Spinoza put forth his theological political treatise, which changed the locals' ways of thinking. Spinoza also set up the monism philosophical system, which stated that all of reality can be made with one substance, God.
Blaise Pascal was a scientist and mathematician from France, who sought to find a way to unite the ideas of science and religion. Through his work, he invented a calculating machine and created the theory of chance and probability. There were some outside sources that influenced Pascal's thinking. On November 23, 1654, he had a mystical vision from God, which led him to publish notes in a series called Pensées.
He continued to advocate for Christianity and wanted to prove that the faith did not differ from reason. In such a scientific world, it was difficult for him to be understood and believed. It was not a successful journey, but its efforts were sincere. By his death, it was clear that secularization had been creating an even larger gap between science and religion.
That's so crazy. I know this may have seemed like a ton of information, but the scientific revolution took place over many years. So many significant people and events were present during this time period. We wanted to inform you of what we saw as most important.
Now go kill it on your AP exam!